Good morning, everybody. Happy Monday. We have an amazing show for everybody today. What do we have, Krystal?
Indeed, we do. Lots of great stuff for you today. So great friend of the show, Zed Jelani, is going to be here to talk about the back and forth between Trump and Biden on China and how that's all going to play out. We have a first-timer to Rising, Julio Vincent Gambutta. He wrote a great piece that caught our eye talking about how we're about to all be gaslit on the coronavirus crisis. So that will be good. And some new comments from Chuck Schumer about a potential AOC primary. Lots of things to get into this morning.
Yeah, we have a lot of fun stories.
But let's start with some new polling data that we've been taking a look at.
That's right. Everybody knows that we love polls. Okay, so state of the race right now. NBC Wall Street Journal released yesterday. Biden 49, Trump 42. Might seem good on the surface for Biden. However, just last month, it was at Biden 52, Trump 43. And if you think about that, that's a pretty important question there about how exactly the country is feeling. We have another poll there from the same NBC Wall Street Journal about who people trust on coronavirus. And you can see there the president at 36% trust, 52% don't trust. But Biden actually at a 26% trust, 29%. So what that number actually says to me, you're seeing a lot of journalists and people out there be like, only one third of the country trust Trump on coronavirus. It's like, yeah,
only a quarter
of the trust his opponent. You can see he doesn't have a high distrust number. And
yeah.
What I think that low distrust number is a reflection of how he's just missing from the conversation.
I think that's exactly right. It shows that sort of like the jury is still out. People don't have a lot of confidence in him to handle it, but they also don't have a lot of distrust in him to handle it. They just haven't seen that much enough to know, frankly.
Right. And I mean, I know you have the Real Clear Politics average as well, kind of just to put everything into context for where people stand right now.
Yeah. So we took a look back at this time during 2016, because I think that trajectory also matters when you're thinking about the head-to-head. So I think this is important to keep in mind in terms of the context. So we see right now Biden up 49-43 on Trump. Well, back in 2016, Hillary was up on Trump 49-39. So she had quite a bit of a wider margin at this point in 2016. Now, look, it's a very different dynamic when you have an incumbent president versus, two challengers effectively. So it is a different dynamic, but I think it's important to keep in mind at this point, she was actually doing better than Joe Biden is right now. And of course, we're in the midst of a crisis. How does that play out? Does that benefit Trump? I'm not sure that it does, especially given the mistakes that he made early on.
Well, that's the thing. We have to think about macro trends. So back to that poll that we had just thrown up there was asked, what do you feel better off than you did 4 years ago? And people do, on a macro level, say that they feel better off than they did 4 years ago at 49-43. And it shows you there, that poll, that all of the endorsements in the world from Obama, from Hillary Clinton, I presume the Hillary one will come, but a lot of the Obama administration heft that Biden is bringing to him does not necessarily have the push with voters that they think it does. Because if when you're running a let's go back to 4 years ago campaign, there has to be an ingrained desire to actually go back to 4 years ago.
Right.
And you can see in that polling that on that macro level, not the case. So then if it's going to be decided in the crisis on coronavirus, as we said, right now, Biden is very much underwater in whether people trust him or not. So as long as the president maintains the country's attention, which, look, that's going to happen. He is the president.
Right.
No matter what. And Biden is in a very big strategic disadvantage because, and I think you've said this, even if Trump is unpopular, right, he's still driving the conversation. He's still moving everything in the direction that he wants. And Biden is just reacting in donor live streams or in, a few cable news appearances per day. That's just not going to cut it in terms of projecting the influence that you need to have with the American people saying, I have got it ready. And this is something that even Democratic strategists had understood. We had Liz Smith, we were talking about last week, saying, I don't understand why he's not doing so much more. And I think a lot of it comes down to like a vigor as a candidate, lack of organization, complacency. And they truly believe they're like, Trump will just bungle this. And I just don't see that happening.
You can't just sit back and let your opponent control, not only because we're talking about two things. There's the reality of his response, and then there's the way he's able to portray it to the country. And those two things are related, but they are not the same. And this is where the news media's approach to the entire Trump era really comes back to bite them, because they have become become enamored with this approach of basically making every story about Trump. Trump is bad. That is the moral of literally every story. Ben Smith at the New York Times actually sort of called out the news media saying, look, yes, Trump is involved in this crisis. He is part of the story, but not every story about the coronavirus crisis is about Donald Trump. But since they have centered their entire networks around this one figure in every single story, that means he has total control over what and when and how things are covered in the news media. So because they have done that, it gives him so much more power in terms of driving the narratives that he wants to drive leading into November. And you're going to talk about this in your radar. We're also going to talk about it with Zed. What is the debate that everyone's having right now? It's about China. That is exactly the debate that this, whatever you think about how he's done there and whether he has the right stance and how you feel about the trade, all those things. Like, that is the one thing you can point to in this administration that, as you pointed out, was different than what the status quo was. I think that the bottom line in terms of what he actually accomplished was very little on the substance, but a lot in terms of, we're not going to be gaslit anymore by these economists who say, oh, you can't have a trade war. It's going to destroy everything. It'll be a catastrophe. Like, we're just not going to believe that anymore. And so he would love to fight this election on the grounds of China. It would be a very strong strategic place for him to stand. And because he has such a giant megaphone that, of course, in part comes with the presidency, but has only been amplified by the news media's obsession with him, he's able to drive that conversation.
That's such an important dynamic, which we're going to cover a little bit later on, because Bill Maher also addresses, which is that, look, and Ben, what Ben's column was about, he's like, this is the biggest story of the decade, right? Like, when you cover these big stories, look, the media used to know how to cover this. During 9/11, not everything was about George W. Bush. It was about the heroes of 9/11. I mean, think back to how that was covered. The first responders, the governors. I mean, so much of, and there's a little bit of that, but it's not even close to the same. Everything, the Trump press conference every single night. And of course, the, what the president of the United States says is a story. But, you know, we've talked about here, Gavin Newsom and London Breed deserve so much credit for shutting down California far earlier on. Their caseload is such a different story to Governor Cuomo and
Jay
de Blasio.
Jay Inslee in Washington as well.
I mean, they had the initial outbreaks and they completely shut things down, responsibly enacted social distancing measures. And at the time, people thought they were crazy. They were like, oh, what? Gavin,
this is way out, over the top.
They got way less cases and they're probably going to end up opening before anybody. Do you see any coverage there? There's a massive, I mean, 55 millions of people live in California. It's like one of the world's largest economies just on its own. That just shows you, again, they only know how to cover their own backyard and the president. So, I mean, it's 2020. And so by driving the conversation in that direction, they're actually gaslighting people into not understanding the broader story. And it's to the point where I think people just don't trust them anymore. And then that is the, that's the real problem that they have, is that they look at them in those briefings. I mean, you see these journalists who really think they're like holding Trump's feet to the fire. I'm like reading his statements back to him. You're like, were you duped by the Chinese government? It's like, how do you, it's like, you're just trying to get into a confrontation. You're not actually trying to elicit information, even though I think this is a legitimate line of questioning.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter. Like, yeah, sure, he should actually be pressed on. And I called him out for it at the time. Why are you fawning over the Chinese whenever they're obviously lying to us? But it's all about the way that you extract information, and it's turning it into a show, again, which he is very comfortable with.
Yeah.
This is, I mean, you know, he loves nothing more than sparring with CNN, calling them fake news, and saying that they're a low-rating network. This it's great, is, and most people like it, too.
Yeah, this is his strongest suit. Like, his greatest innovation, insight in terms of politics was how to essentially make them create a media feeding frenzy, but one that is on your grounds, on your turf. And so even if the coverage is negative, you get to drive that coverage. You get to be the central character in that coverage. And that just puts the ball in your court. And that is exacerbated even more so. I mean, that was certainly the case when it was Hillary Clinton, when it was, you know, fairly equal footing, because you have, you know, nobody's an incumbent. So both are challengers trying to come in the White House for the first time. So it's fairly equal footing in terms of who the press might cover. He was able to do that then. And Hillary was, frankly, a more able candidate in terms of just her sort of verbal acuity and ability to articulate a vision. That is even more so the case now that you have this lopsided dynamic of an incumbent, which always gives you certain advantages versus a challenger. And then you're a challenger who really has not number one, been pressed on any of your vulnerabilities, right. hasn't been sharpened. I mean, you remember the way that the debate coverage would always go. First of all, he was never questioned or challenged by the moderators. But then the way they would evaluate his performance, it was like, well, we had an incredibly low bar for Joe Biden, and he met it. So way to go, Joe. Great work tonight. You were incredible. He never had to go through that sharpening experience. He never had to go through that revealing experience of the primary. And now you have this really untested, unprepared in terms of his mental acuity challenger. It just puts the ball even more in Trump's court. And look, we always want to say Trump is behind right now.
Yeah.
Right?
If the election
was held today, it's very possible that he could and would lose. But you ask yourself, who has sort of the advantages in terms of being able to fight on the ground that they want to fight on? There's no doubt that Trump is able to drive this narrative and create the conversations and the debates that he wants to have.
Right. Then see, this is what we try to bring you on the show, is the actual understandings and the trends within the polls, rather than, oh, you know, 49, what is it? It's 49-42. People will come away from that being like, oh, Biden is up by 7 points. And you're like, listen, you got to compare it to last time. You got to look right. at the fact that Biden actually dropped 4 points in the same poll over the last month while Trump is flat. How does that happen? So right. what does that tell you? The fact that actually Trump's approval rating of handling of the coronavirus is gone up 2 points over the last month in the poll. So again, these are all things where they'll be like, well, the majority of the country disagrees with Trump on his handling of this. But, you know, if you can start to see macro and micro level trends, it can tell you where things are going. Look at the major indicators, which is the economy. Like I said, when your whole campaign and its message is predicated on things were better off 4 years ago and the majority of the country doesn't believe that exact sentiment, you're going to have a problem connecting with that.
Right.
And you need to hope that that becomes an underwater figure and basically hope that the country goes into a Great Depression. Now, look, I think that that is possible. But one of the things that I think you covered here a few months ago is that Trump is actually, you cannot count on the fact that with economic downturn that he would lose, because he thrives actually as an underdog person fighting back against an uphill battle and actually trying to marshal political forces in that political forces towards beating yourself out of a crisis, out of chaos. I actually think he lost his way in his presidency when things started to look up economically,
because he didn't know how to handle it.
He was talking to like Gary Cohn and all these people who were telling sweet nothings about Wall Street. It's whenever things were down and he was up in an underdog fighting against the system that he actually was much better at what he was doing.
So he knows how to weaponize a crisis and how to create a narrative around who the real villains are in that crisis. You can see him trying to do that. I mean, it's very blatantly obvious what he's trying to do here. And the media knows what he's trying to do in terms of like placing the blame on China and focusing on them, which there is, like, with all good narratives, there has to be some truth there. There is some truth there. It's also true that that's a distraction from the bungling of his early days approach, but they can't resist.
No.
They can't resist having that debate and getting into exactly what he wants to talk about, and that's the dynamic of the race right now.
Yeah, it really is.
We're going to tell you what's on our radar, so that's next.